So, it was 3 years ago today.
True.
What happened?
Today.
3 years ago today.
At lunchtime.
At lunchtime.
At lunchtime.
So what happened?
In these 3 years.
3 years ago today, what happened?
The actual day.
Yeah.
You or me. Both of us.
I think holidays is so hard, especially for immigrants. Mm-hmm. You really miss your family. And I think I was really sad, like today, because I'm not there. But I'm happy that now they are coming. So they will be visiting a little bit in January. Mm-hmm. But after that, we spent like several Christmas and New Year's in Venezuela. And that was really something that I was needing. And well, then we went to, we were in the mid, at the end of the campaign. It was so, I think, a very hard time and very busy. And we went for lunch and we had this disagreement about going to Venezuela and taking Theo and being apart. And what I was like asking is like, we need some help. We need to go to a therapist or, and then I just didn't hear, I think, and he was not listening to me, I was not listening to him, and then he grabbed my arm, and that's it.
And did he hurt you?
No. I mean, I am always plane and I ride bike, I do hiking, so mm-hmm. I think I'm very strong, but what hurts me was the situation that we were not communicating and we were like really needing someone to help us to mm-hmm. communicate better.
So you went to Ivory Madison and you did the video and you said this isn't the first time. What was that?
But I explained that, and this is not the first time we are having this problem about this disagreement about going to Venezuela. Mm-hmm. And at that moment, I didn't understand how hard it was for Ross to be far from Theo. Ross grew up without his dad. After finally we were together again and we could do therapy, I understood that. How important is that for him? At that moment, I was like, what is the problem? Why I cannot just go to Venezuela and come back with Theo? So it took us, we really need that help to listen and understand each other.
Do you think you guys would still be married if this hadn't happened?
You know,
he's a very precocious little boy.
I think we were needing an intervention, and I think the system intervened, maybe not in the most positive way, but I think we are better now. It was really a test for us. And that put everything in perspective, like how big is our compromise, commitment to each other. Mm-hmm. And we really learn. I learn a lot, and I think Ross is a better person, a better husband, a better father. I think that was really a test.
Yeah.
So what should have happened? Once Ivory Madison calls the police and they get involved, what do you guys think should have happened?
I was the last to know. I didn't know about any of this that it had happened. So it all walloped me. It all walloped me because, you know, I was days before becoming sworn in as sheriff. I actually do believe in the process and the system and felt that once that there was an activated case or system with very little understanding of what just had occurred between Eliana and this woman, the next door neighbor, and what she did without Eliana's consent. And as Eliana's explaining to me, she felt extremely exploited and taken advantage of. Mm-hmm. I wasn't sure what to do except just allow the system to proceed, and I did. I just said it's got to go in its own course. It was only in that ensuing two or three week period, it was just taking a very distorted shape in my familiarity with the system, and their dismissiveness of Eliana, and more of a, so it was like, all right, well, let's just see where this goes.
I think for me, it was very confusing. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know very well the system. So it was confusing. It was scary. It was like a threat or prosecute me.
Mm-hmm. You were a citizen at the time.
It was like child protection coming home and interview us. So I felt very alone. And I think the people that should be there to helping me, like nonprofits that works with domestic violence, never reached out to me. I think maybe if I feel more support, what do you need? What is what you want? What is the, because I was in the middle of the situation. My family was forced apart. Decision was making without my consent. So it was confusing and it was scary. And I was really feeling alone. And I was like not having any communication with Ross. Mm-hmm. So that is something that, to feel safe, luckily I have the opportunity to be out of the city, out of the country. Uh-huh. Not to feel safe for Ross, to feel safe for the craziness that having people in my front door, my address, my name in the newspaper, my mails, my text, all my life out there in the newspapers, and everybody making conclusions without talking to me. And I think the people that should be there to talk with me and support me was not there.
So what do you think the police should have done? They see this, they get this call from a woman, and the call from the woman suggests that she's been, they think maybe something's happening to her. She goes to them, they tell her, no, it's my friend. What should they have done?
If I knew what I know right now, they were lawyers, and if you are a lawyer, you cannot, if your office is there, you cannot open and the police cannot come because it's a confidentiality agreement. Mm-hmm.
But what should the police have done? What do you think the police should have done, and what do you think George Gascon should have done?
I think they needed to do what the law requires them to do. And this is why I wanted the system to proceed uninterrupted. I think what I didn't do is explain myself, because I was just shell-shocked and paralyzed. And I was... I just retracted. One second,
people. Let's break a moment, because we have a problem here.
What's the problem?
Papi.
He can sit here.
Te puedes sentar aquí, pero daddy está.
Careful of the wire. Entrevista. Careful of the wire, boo-boo.
She's already taken, she unhooked it.
One of them, there's two.
Nos tienes que dejar, no te podemos leer el libro. Do you want, quieres ver el final de Shrek?
And you can look at it, and I'll read it a little bit later. Okay. So I think it was the lack of
communication. You never cooperated with that investigation.
There was never any real approach for cooperation.
Well, did they arrested you?
Well, I turned myself
in. They questioned
you. It
was
processed. No, there was never any questions.
They never tried to question you?
There was never any exchange. There was never any exchange. There was never any exchange at all. The attorney I had at the time was very clear that we didn't know what meaning we were dealing with here.
Is that Wagoner?
Yes, my first attorney.
Yeah, okay.
At the time.
Uh-huh.
And that seemed like sound advice to me.
Uh-huh. So you basically said that you were not going to talk to them. Did you, I mean, that you were going to
I never said I wasn't going to talk to them. I don't think that that ever really evolved. But at the moment, there wasn't this, like, can we talk to... I was never approached to say, they like to talk to you, do you want to talk to them or not talk to them?
But you could have also gone to them and said, look, this is way out of control, let me tell you what happened.
Oh, yes. And I did not do that.
And you should have done it.
I wish I had.
Uh-huh.
I completely wish I had.
Uh-huh.
Are you kidding? I mean, hindsight is everything, right? But
uh-huh.
in that particular moment, I was just so, I was paralyzed. I really was. And I was trying to regroup with my family and the understanding of what was occurring and crashing around us.
Mm-hmm.
And then the advice I was getting is, you need to regroup,
mm-hmm.
do so through prepping up with the legal process. And that essentially was the advice I was listening to, coinciding with the fact that I'm just now taking office as sheriff, trying to manage this, and I see my family completely under, becoming under the weight of the system.
Mm-hmm.
And so, this was a very, I just wasn't trained for this.
So, as a sheriff, did you have maybe sort of a civic obligation to be more cooperative?
Well, that's why I wouldn't use any of my authority mm-hmm. as a supervisor.
Mm-hmm.
My political connections as a supervisor, mm-hmm. or even coming in as the newly minted sheriff, never once would I exercise any of those connections because I felt an obligation to go through the process.
Mm-hmm.
But the process in itself seemed to not operate in the way that I understood it with other people. It seemed mm-hmm. to be making this very amplified case, and it was just not a process that looked very familiar.
I'm just turning my volume off. Okay.
So being more proactive and upfront, I absolutely do wish. I wish mm-hmm. we were able to say, like, listen, like the press conference, I don't mm-hmm. know if you were there or not.
No.
It was just a few days after the incident, and it was the day of my inaugural
mm-hmm.
at the Herbst Theater.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing event. There were 1,000 people there. And so the stress, you were asking Eliana about what happened on December 31st. What happened is I freaked out on
mm-hmm.
December 31st.
Mm-hmm.
I made a terrible mistake that I overreacted because I was scared that an impending trip that Eliana and Theo were taking to Venezuela, that my mm-hmm. fear was about their safety. She's known in her own right, well known in her own right in Caracas.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just now on the way to be inaugurated as sheriff, and all I hear about is kidnappings and crime and public safety problems down there. And in my arrogant self,
mm-hmm.
and in my arrogant self, when we were not communicating, and I needed to control the conversation, I reached out and I grabbed her arm to say, please listen to me. And that was wrong, completely mm-hmm. wrong. And then everything took off from there. And that was a culmination of, I think, my... subordinating my family during my campaign for sheriff
mm-hmm.
And my need to be that that omnipotent kind of guy, that supervisor
mm-hmm.
who just was had to be everywhere in my district, who had to be Johnny on the spot, who wanted to be popular, who wanted to just be effective, who wanted to be successful
mm-hmm.
and I did not, I didn't put my family first in the way that I should have. And that, the stress of that zoomed into that very day of December 31st.
And you just didn't want to have to accommodate this.
accommodate what?
Your wife wanting to leave. I mean,
no, she's right about something that came out in therapy. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's true. I mean, the whole thing about the possibility of, I'm paranoid about that. I still am. We have to work through it. But when my son travels and travels to a place that makes me feel that their safety is vulnerable, mm-hmm. I had to go to therapy for that. Mm-hmm. I did. I had to work this out.
Were you afraid she'd never come back?
No, but that got mixed into the whole narrative with her and the neighbor and everything else. Mm-hmm. And maybe I wasn't in touch in how I was being so, no, not maybe, I was not in touch mm-hmm. with how I was being, you know, not paying attention. I wasn't home for dinner. I was a 24/7 soup, you know, mm-hmm. and a candidate for sheriff. Mm-hmm. And I think she rightfully was sending all the signals and I wasn't paying attention. And it just all spiked on that New Year's Day mm-hmm. on our way to Delfina Pizza. We were all stressed because we know we can't get in without a reservation. And he was really hungry. Mm-hmm. And if he doesn't eat by a certain time, it mm-hmm. was just going to be this like volcanic thing in the car. And that's what happened. Trust me, they have to eat exactly at the right time.
Yeah. So, so what do you think? What do you think that? So if you had behaved differently, do you think you would have gotten a better deal from the DA's office?
Oh, I don't know. All I know is that, it, in many ways, I do feel the system worked. I think that they were. I think that while they were focusing on me, I don't believe that they were sensitive to the needs of Eliana or Theo and my family, and that mm-hmm. did bother me. Tremendously bothered me when people were using Eliana to invoke the need about calling attention to domestic violence and abuse and everything else, but yet at the same time isolating her or dismissing what she had to say. That to me seemed mm-hmm. to be a real paradox mm-hmm. In the system in itself. But mano to mano, what they were doing with me, I all along was trying to trust and believe in the integrity of the system. As sheriff, I had to.
But you didn't really talk to them either. You didn't make a point of saying, here's my side of the story. So that's
Well, we did. I mean, in my second attorney, we absolutely did mm-hmm. do that.
And which attorney is this?
Lydia
oh, yeah.
Stiglich.
Okay, yeah.
Lydia
okay.
Stiglich. Yeah. And so we did, but by that point, things had already evolved and had already evolved with both sides sort of, you know, preparing for whatever, discussion or trial or what have you. It moved, you know, fairly quick and it was being well splayed in the press. Mm-hmm. A lot of it, where the press themselves were just carrying on with their own narrative. So I think it was just about keeping, you know, focused at hand. The focus for me was maintaining mm-hmm. the department, mm-hmm. Some stability to the department, mm-hmm. Not doing the best I can of trying not to let the radiating effects of what was occurring, but more importantly, concurrently, mm-hmm. dealing with family. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Eliana, so you, how do you feel, did the system work for you?
I, you know, something that I learned during that period is like the system really, it worked, of course mm-hmm. it worked, but it needs to be improved. Mm-hmm. You never imagine how hard it is to be forced apart of your family, mm-hmm. how that really breaks you, how it really is. It's so bad. It's so wrong.
And now, how long were you guys apart?
6 months.
6 months. In 6 months, you were not allowed to talk to each other?
We didn't have any contact, except maybe through
intermediaries.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. And you could only see Theo on supervised visits, or did that change?
No.
But we were fighting like for 1 month and a half.
I mean, I have to tell you, when they used, see, this is what changed the complexion of what I thought needed to proceed. When they started to use Theo as what I felt at the time was a weapon to just break me, so that I would walk away from the office of sheriff, then I really felt that they went out of bounds. That was beyond crushing. I mean, they hit me and hit me very hard, because I didn't understand why Theo had to be separated. There was never an explanation for that, and it was brutal. There was never any threat. There was never any endangerment. There was nothing, ever.
And it was brutal, not only for Ross, it was also for Theo. And it's why I was in court 3 times, I think, saying he really needs to see his dad. This is wrong. We are strong, we can do this, but Theo was at that time 2 years old, and he couldn't express his feeling. So he was having emotional rash in his skin, crying, when he is really a happy boy, well-behaved, well-regulated. So it was hard. And we were like fighting 3 or 4 times in court to finally he was able to be with dad for 2 days.
On a very limited visit.
For 2 hours.
Very limited visits. But it did feel we're very close. I mean, we are as close as I think is a father and son, as a wife, husband, and, you know, and child should be. We are close.
And you, I don't think you would have been this close if this hadn't happened.
Oh, I mean, what's the Hemingway quote? It says, the world breaks us, and afterwards we're stronger in some of the broken places. Mm-hmm. Yes, I agree. We're stronger for it. In that level of adversity, I mean, yes.
But, yeah.
We are more solid for it. We are more happy. I mean, the damning thing is that it's true. I mean, I've seen in my capacity as sheriff and touching bottom at the same time what this kind of impact in the criminal justice system does to families. The high majority of families statistically don't survive processes like this. Mm-hmm. Some should not survive processes for the sake of the woman, for the sake of the child, for the sake of somebody who's abused. So to paint us with that general template that was us too, misunderstood who we are at the same time. Mm-hmm. So we've worked so hard to make this work.
But something that is, yes, he was working so much. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but since Theo was born, I was having these strong rules that if you are going to be in the table with us, you cannot be in the phone, you cannot have the computer. So you have to be there having breakfast or lunch or dinner or whatever. The time that you are there, you have to be with us, not watching TV, reading books to Theo. And it was hard for him at the beginning, because he was like, but this is a baby. How am I going to read a book to him?
Oh.
Read it. And he learned to do that.
Reading
and
is very special time for him.
Yes, but it was a process.
Yeah.
And then I was like, every Saturday, you make the breakfast. You take Theo for swimming. You, at least at 8 a.m., you are there.
And when
they were forced apart, that was the moment when he felt, and we felt, how they were missing each other. And I think that paid a price. Like, all that 2 years, like, sit down. Don't be in the computer. Don't be in the cell phone. Don't watch TV. Be here with Theo. Then he developed this strong relationship with Theo.
Be present.
Exactly.
So, Eliana, I can't tell you how many people told me, you're a battered woman. You're a battered woman, so you're going to you're covering up. That's what women do. Women cover up. How do you feel about that?
Well, I feel it's very insulting. Mm-hmm. I feel also race makes a lot of play an important role here. Mm-hmm. I think if I were white and I say I'm not an abused woman. I am very strong. I am independent. And I just want to deal with my problems in a healthy way. I want to have my family together. Mm-hmm. And I have a strong rules at home. Mm-hmm. So I'm not any battered woman. If I were white, maybe people can listen. And I think that race plays a little bit unfortunately.
I'm darker you said, than you.
Yeah. You said it was political persecution. That you said it was political persecution. You still hold to that.
I think politics plays a lot of.
So there are people who thought you're the progressive.
Wait a minute. Do you not think, especially after the last couple of years, politics still does not have a role in this? The way it manifests in other campaigns and things?
I have always felt that they were afraid not to go after you because how do you, with the video, not go after the guy? Now, at a certain point, they could have handled everything completely differently.
And as we could have, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, no question.
Exactly.
But I'm only asking for perspective here.
Uh-huh.
Because I remember at first as I was trying to figure out what was happening, mm-hmm. and I was hit back hard when I and others around me were saying, this is politics. Mm-hmm. And I was like, how dare you say it's politics? It's not. But I think it has manifested itself into being a very political, charged.
Well, was it because, I mean, the sort of, there were people who thought you're the progressive, you're sort of a potential rival to Ed Lee, and that's why they're picking on you. It has nothing to do with what happened.
I mean, that's for pundits and analysts, but it's true. I mean, our campaigns did correspond at the same time. Mm-hmm. We did extremely well, better than we had thought in our campaign for sheriff in a very spirited race. Mm-hmm. The vote totals positioned me well. I mean, for somebody who would be concerned that they may be facing me down the road in a potential mayoral race. But I was always very clear I was going to be sheriff for at least two terms. Mm-hmm. We'll see then.
Are you running for re-election?
I am.
Okay.
Yeah. And I look forward, enthusiastically, I look forward as a candidate for re-election to present the progress and accomplishments, you know, that we've achieved over my time as sheriff. And I realize it's going to be a real challenge to break through with all the other taint and chatter that's out there, but
You can't carry a gun.
Mike Hennessy didn't carry a gun either. Yeah. That doesn't handicap me from being a sheriff. Mm-hmm. And I can elect to carry a gun after probation.
After probation,
yeah,
so
sure,
after March.
Sure.
Now, what's it like being a sheriff who's on probation?
It hasn't interrupted my ability to be sheriff at all. It's essentially, it's called non-supervised probation. And there's just, it just let, the clock needs to run its course. That's what it is.
But I mean, I would venture to guess, I could be wrong, you may know the answer to this, that you're the only sheriff in the United States who's on probation. Maybe not.
I don't know.
Certainly for a major city. Has it given you a perspective? Does it hinder you? Does it make you a better sheriff?
Well, no, I appreciate that question. And so let's go there for a second. Do I think it makes me a better sheriff? Do I think any of this experience has made me a better sheriff? Yes, I do. I do think it does. I think it has, one, I think it has humbled me tremendously as a leader, mm-hmm. Unlike in the way that I ever been humbled when I was a supervisor or candidate for sheriff. Two, I have seen the sort of the underbelly and the inside of the criminal justice system that I find even in San Francisco sometimes very pretentious. Mm-hmm. And it opened my eyes to areas that I believe need significant reform and challenge. Because San Francisco, I think sometimes people get lulled mm-hmm. into this false sense of, it's San Francisco. We've got our act together. Mm-hmm.